Per usual, everything on this channel is for educational purposes only and is not intended as financial advice. It's Teaching Tech Tuesday. Let's take a look at some of the mammoth people across time here. Originally, this was going to be a Dow Theory video focusing on how mean reversion and edge-to-edge trades in the cloud are part of Dow Theory, but maybe I'm misremembering that. I don't see that as one of the tenets of Dow Theory, but in any event, it's worth knowing who these next people are here. Charles Dow, Richard Wyckoff, and Goichi Hosoda. Hopefully I'm not butchering that. Interesting that they were all kind of standing on the shoulders of giants of each other, in a sense. Dow and Wyckoff, both in the United States. Hosoda in Japan. His work was interrupted by World War II. And like it says here, he spent 30 years developing the cloud, but what I find interesting is how closely tied all this stuff is. Slight variations on the theme. You know, you'd probably say that Wyckoff came along and took what Dow observed and made it a little bit more specific, a little bit more actionable in my mind. But you'll notice all the stuff I'm about to talk about is kind of in the modern zeitgeist of technical analysis, how we understand markets, what we look for in markets. Also interesting to me, for some reason, that Dow died kind of young, I guess, you know, at that time, fairly into advanced age at 1902. And then Wyckoff died in 1934 in his 60s. I believe Hosoda died in 82 at around age 89. So he did live a little longer. Something else that's always interesting to look at is, did these people make money? You know, if you look at some of these historical technical analysis people, they either died penniless or they committed suicide. Like, it's usually not a happy story for some of these people. Always just another interesting data point here. But Dow developed the Dow Jones Industrial Average, co-founded Wall Street Journal. He was a journalist that was putting together these kind of snippets about markets. And again, similar to Twitter, similar to a lot of what we see in market analysis around crypto even, but in the early days of Wall Street. So just a massive influence on markets. And then Wyckoff, again, coming a little bit later, the Wyckoff people might come after me. But to me, when I look at the two, Dow and Wyckoff, they're pretty similar in the descriptions of the markets. I'll get to that in a second. But it just makes you wonder, you know, who was aware of one another? There's also Gann. There's also the Elliott Wave guy, right? there's all these characters around the same time-ish who could have obviously been aware of each other's work. TA in and of itself is kind of always looking at the same thing, coming to the same conclusions in different ways. And the same to be said with Hosoda. You know, did he know of Dow and Wyckoff? I assume he did, but it's impossible to know. This is pretty much the only picture of Hosoda you're going to see on the internet. Kind of a criminal offense that we don't have a Wikipedia page on the guy, but I think there's actually a statue of him in Japan somewhere. Anyway, so Dow Theory has six basic tenets. I'll go over this in a better way in a second, but market has three movements. Market trends have three phases. Efficient market hypothesis is number three. The stock market averages must confirm each other is number four. And that's not, you know, the 50 and the 200 moving average. In his case, he was talking about a rail company index versus a industrial index. I'll come back to that in a second. Volume, super important for Dow Theory. On volume breakouts, again, this is all stuff that's kind of super basic common sense technical analysis where you want to see volume confirmation to confirm anything, right? To confirm trend, to confirm chart pattern breakouts, that sort of thing. And then the last piece, trends exist unless definitive signals prove that they have ended. And oftentimes you'll hear people talking about, you know, trading the reversals or looking for the reversals. Even now when we sit here at 42K in Bitcoin, you know, I'm thinking to myself, historically, how long have we had? Well, we've historically had 7 to 20 weeks at a top in a similar spot pre-halving. So I don't think there's any rush to come to any judgment here. Definitely have to give this a little bit of time. And if we just look at the summary of Dow Theory, very basic stuff for anybody who's paid attention to technical analysis for almost any amount of time. The kind of oddball one is the stock market averages confirming each other. And I don't know how applicable it would be necessarily to today's markets, but if we look at the S&P, the NASDAQ, the Dow Jones, and IWM, the small cap index, to me, it certainly looks like they all confirm each other. Now, the industrial DJI back in the day versus the railroad index, rail company index, I don't know if those included similar stocks. I'd have to go back and check. But, you know, the S&P, the NASDAQ have similar components. But this, to me, is a very healthy sign to see everything across the board making all-time highs. So I think Dow himself would be impressed with that. And I think he would say, look, this is super bullish. I didn't have volume on these, but volume is also bullish. Sure, we're due for a pullback, obviously, but definitely looks to me like we are trending in the right direction. The difficulty I have with Dow theory is it's hard to know like what to label and what to look at versus Wyckoff, where it has hyper-specific things, also somewhat subjective, but very, very specific names for certain price movements. And again, kind of similar to Wyckoff, we've got accumulation, we've got distribution, which are definitely key in Wyckoff. The types of market movements, primary, secondary, minor trends, are kind of the same way of saying minor pullbacks versus a 20% primary move would be a primary trend determiner. So this is all kind of broad strokes, looking at the trees, looking at the forest, sorry, rather than the trees type situation. Volume is also tough in crypto. I've done a video on volume. It's hard because we've had so many different exchanges dominate over time. We've had different products dominate on different exchanges over time. We've had different regions of the world dominating those markets at different times. So there really hasn't been a constant volume that you can look at. We can look at individual exchanges and say, okay, Coinbase has dominance now, Binance's dominance is waning. We can look at CME, we can look at more regulated stuff these days versus the offshore unregulated exchanges. But as a whole, collectively, I think volume is just a really tough thing to look at and take seriously broadly. I think on an exchange by exchange basis, on a pair by pair basis, you can definitely do that, but you have to know what you're looking at. And one of the benefits of the cloud, talking about trend reversals, knowing the cloud and knowing chart patterns, the edge-to-edge trades that have come up over the past couple weeks here across the board, those are identifying when we have a change of character. Those are identifying when we're ending the accumulation phase and entering a markup phase, if we're talking Wyckoff. But having that period of essentially ranging nothingness, range-bound nothingness, is super common amongst all charts, any market throughout the history of the world. Okay, whether it's GME, AMC, Helium, Bitcoin, doesn't matter. You're going to see very similar stuff because at the end of the day, people are trading this. Everybody's trading this. This is human behavior just identified, just different flavors of the same beast. One of the schematics I was able to pull, a lot of these are like potato quality, by the way, because at this point they've been shared so many times by so many different websites. It's hard to find the primary source of any of this stuff. But this would be an example, super bare bones, Dow theory, accumulation, public participation, excess, which again, euphoria, right? Distribution, public participation and panic or fear, right? Mania at the top, fear at the bottom. All words I'm sure you've heard before. Volume also very important. This kind of looks like, 2017 Bitcoin a little bit, right? You can see shades of certain markets on various timeframes in things like this. And it makes sense, right? When you think about what's next for Bitcoin, for example, most likely it's going to be more public participation. What happened with Bonk, right? What happened with Solana? You had extreme public participation on a relative basis compared to the accumulation phase, right? The accumulation phase generally boring, sideways, range bound, right? Look at Link, same thing. Link had a multi-month range bound phase. Look at gold, right? Again, up here, gold arguably has been in a multi-year accumulation phase. So I think once you know what types of forests to look for, right? Are we burning the forest down? Are we planting trees? Are we harvesting the lumber? Just as an analogy, And I think it helps to recognize mainly, are we in accumulation or are we in distribution, right? Just broadly across the board on anything, it's important to have an opinion on that at least. And to contrast that with Wyckoff, again, to me, Wyckoff and Dow are kind of very, very similar. Wyckoff will call this markup or markdown, but otherwise accumulation, distribution, same thing. This is, again, a bare bones schematic of Wyckoff. And it goes deep on Wyckoff, extremely deep as far as labeling every little thing, throughout price action. You know, this is nothing compared to the actual schematic when we're talking about buying climax, automatic rally, jumping the creek, right? So I think knowing this in a bare bones form is super useful just to get a sense of bearings of like, where could we be? My problem in general with Wyckoff is that it's a little too subjective, especially if you're newer. I think you're going to have a hard time trying to figure out what's what. It should never be murky. It should always be fairly obvious for the most part, where you're going to see a spring, you're going to see a low volume sell off that goes nowhere. You're going to see a retest of support. You know, so we are broadly, I think, in altcoin land and Bitcoin land, definitely in the markup phase for some of this stuff, or ending the accumulation phase across the board. I don't talk about volume enough, I'll admit, but again, it's hard to know what exactly to look at in general. Previously, it was Bitfinex. Now, again, maybe it's Coinbase, maybe it's CME. We're going to have spot ETFs, so we're going to have another product to look at. But volume is also definitely a key determiner of range-bound accumulation, where you see a drop-off in volume pretty steadily, and then you start to see a crescendo in volume towards the end of the accumulation phase. And then for the most part, you sustain that volume during the markup phase. Then during the euphoric mania, right, all the public's like, oh, I can't wait to buy on Coinbase, let me download the app. You know, that's when you typically see another volume spike. And then throughout this low volume distribution phase, there's kind of another lull until the breakdown starts to happen, and then volume picks up in a big, big way. I'll put all these in the description of this video with some additional reading, but it's just interesting to kind of go through the charts and see where you think things are, if this helps you in your trading or not. You know, for some people, they're not going to care, right? You know, like, how would I apply this to Bonk? I don't know. it's just in the mania public participation excess phase, right? If we go a step deeper into the Wyckoff stuff, this is what I'm talking about when we're labeling the accumulation phase. There's multiple schematics for each phase: sign of strength, last point of support, selling test, I think this is, selling climax, automatic rally. For me, it's easiest to identify the accumulation and distribution stuff. It's definitely harder to identify markup, markdown relative to the Wyckoff schematics. Obviously, you know if we're making higher highs or higher lows, but it's hard for me to really know necessarily, are we in phase A, right? Or are we in early phase B, for example? Not that that really, really matters, but we can look at certain examples throughout time. You're never going to see a better textbook example of Wyckoff accumulation than Bitcoin in 2015. I didn't know about Wyckoff till probably 2017. And looking back on it, it made a lot of sense. You have your accumulation and then your sign of strength with this 250-day ascending triangle. But even in today's charts, you know, you're seeing various shades of this on various timeframes. This is silver. Now, silver to me clearly had a Wyckoff accumulation from 2014 to 2021. And it's in some sort of markup phase here. But again, like, what do you do with this? I think you assume that it's bullish, should lead to higher highs. I think the focus on point of resistance here makes sense as far as the diagonals. Maybe there's a chart pattern in here as well as some other stuff. I don't know. But just because it doesn't fit the Wyckoff schematics exactly doesn't discount it entirely, right? And once you know this exists, you'll start to see various versions of this, you know, whether or not it's pareidolia or not, I don't care. You're just looking at the forest, right? Just broad strokes here, broad strokes. I personally like chart patterns a little better. I think they define price action a little better and give you some guardrails as far as what to look for. But when we're talking multi-year cycles, you know, Wyckoff, definitely very invaluable. The same thing with Dow theory. And in the second schematic, you'll notice there's no spring here. And one thing that immediately came to mind was this helium chart, HNT. Now, I don't think people are painting the chart, right? This is just repetitive human behavior that we tend to see at the top or at the bottom of markets. And these do work on any time frame, but most of the time you're going to see the best versions of this are on multi-month timeframes, I would argue. Now, I would just call this a vanilla inverted head and shoulders. There was a cloud edge-to-edge move over here as well. And it's good to see that all these systems sort of lining up, telling you the same thing, depending on where you want to draw your support resist lines, right? Maybe you move these down a little bit and your entries would get closer to two rather than 250, whatever, right? The point is, this thing has done very well. And had I been paying attention to this a little bit more, I would have traded it, but I wasn't. So it's definitely important to do a scan and identify what's going on across the market. This is GME. And again, I don't think this fits like a specific schematic, right? But very clearly it had a long accumulation period where you also had people who were mega, mega short, shorting this all the way up, expecting this to go to zero. And guess what we also had in Bitcoin in 2016? We also had a mega, mega, mega short squeeze for continuation here. I don't know how that lines up with the Wyckoff stuff generally, but the most powerful moves are often squeezes like that where we consolidate for a long time and people are expecting one direction. It's a crowded trade and it goes against them. Another thing about Wyckoff is you can have multiple accumulation or distribution phases. Can be hard to identify, I think. It's hard to know when that fails versus when it's another accumulation or distribution, right? Like what makes this accumulation versus distribution? That's a question for the Wyckoff experts, but not something I typically tackle on a day-to-day basis. If we look at the distribution phases, they're basically a mirror of the distribution, the accumulation phases, right? Generally the same thing you're looking for on the bear side. And if we look at Bitcoin in 2021, throughout 2022, I don't know if I'd necessarily call this Wyckoffian. There probably were people who are identifying it as that. There were probably people identifying various stages of this entire block as Wyckoffian, you know, at the top in 2021, in March, at the top in November. My guess is there were people identifying some Wyckoff stuff there. I know Crypto Jack, another content creator, deep into Wyckoff, definitely talking about Bitcoin at those times. So I think Wyckoff is useful to understand, but it's you got to also understand it's not always going to apply to everything all the time. I think the Wyckoff purists probably try to apply it all the time, you know, try to identify which stages of the rallies we're in, where we're at. You know, one that's live right now, if we're talking about a distribution, is ETH-BTC. You know, I don't know if this is some outstretched phase D relative to another phase B. You know, I'm not that deep in Wyckoff, but I don't think it's that far off that this is probably some sort of distribution phase, right, that we're in now. And we will probably see some lower lows here over the next couple months on ETH-BTC. I don't think that's some brave call to make. I mean, we're making continuously lower lows here, right? That's part of any trend system, DAO, Wyckoff, or otherwise. And we've also been bearish on the cloud pretty continuously since the beginning of 2023, at least on the daily. So we have some of these older schematics, right? And now I think this is probably one that people are most familiar with. It's funny that this website doesn't even exist anymore if you try to go to wallstreetcheatsheet.com. So again, these charts are kind of potato quality, but very similar to what has happened historically in crypto. We've seen multiple cycles of this on large caps, small caps, micro caps. You're going to see it on Bonk, right? It doesn't matter because this is people trading. That's just what people do. Go to the South Sea bubble chart, right? You're going to see the same thing. And again, on here, you see a pretty extended accumulation phase relative to a distribution phase. I would call this also an inverted Adam and Eve at the top. You could call that an M double top. But I think broadly in crypto land, we're closer to the depression disbelief phase, and we are on our way to hope and optimism. That's what it feels like to me. For some alts, they are certainly still in anger and depression, for sure. But in the coins that have moved, Bitcoin, Solana, you know, ETH is probably closer to depression at this point. You know, let's be honest, right? AVAX, probably closer to disbelief and hope. The tough part comes in, when are we in belief, thrill, or euphoria, right? What do we use to identify it? Is that headlines? Is that volume? Are those products coming online, coming offline? As I like to say, everything is a data point. Your parents texting you, you seeing some headline, everybody's getting rich and you're not, right? There's always evidence of various stages. And broadly, I think it's valuable to know where we're at, right? So I think definitely we're closer in depression and disbelief. I think the cloud specifically helps you identify the trades and the setups, but these schematics can also help determine where we're at in the market. You know, if we look at Total 3, for example, that this does not look like a chart that's in depression. You know, it's making higher highs. it's exiting range-bound levels. There are tons of alts that are doing extremely well. I don't know if this is Wyckoffian necessarily. Could be, right? But knowing or not knowing that doesn't really help or hurt me. It just gives me pause and asks the question, you know? But the cloud specifically says, this is when we'll probably be bullish. This is where we were bearish. This is where that ends. That's why I really like the cloud in the trend system. It really helps specify that for you. There's also this great chart where it sort of labels the type of investor who gets into the market. Both Wyckoff and Dow make a comment about the smart money who's in during essentially what is the accumulation phase. And you've got the public, aka dumber money or dumb money, coming in basically at the top, right? And again, you've seen this, if you've been here multiple cycles, you know exactly what I'm talking about, because you've probably been one of these people, including myself in 2013, who's in this delusion new paradigm, buying right at the top and either capitulating or holding on or whatever you may do. And we'll start to see media attention with the ETFs, right? So then we get the beginnings of the mania phase. We typically do get some sort of bear trap around the halving. So that's something we'll watch for in the checklist of things, right? I think everybody's worried about, you know, where's the down move going to happen? When is it going to happen? Why would it happen? So even though a lot of these crypto charts are up 100%, 300% on the year, it still very much feels to me like 2024 into 2025 is where we're really going to see the markets move. Because on the schematic, there's really not that many people here yet. There's not even, you know, relative to BTC, every time I talk to somebody, they tell me they're not even allocated to BTC. They don't even care, right? We've got people trading meme coins, which is fine, right? You're going to get a bigger upside potentially percentage-wise. But we are very much not in enthusiasm, greed, delusion, right? We're nowhere close to any of that stuff. We are just starting the awareness phase, or in the awareness phase, in my mind, of this cycle. Lastly, I'll leave you with the ChatGPT. I asked, what's the similarities and differences between Wyckoff and Dow? And the similarities it pointed out were price and volume, trend, and market psychology, which that's fair. They both basically talk about the same thing in that regard. The differences that ChatGPT pointed out were, you know, this is kind of a softball, but Dow versus Wyckoff. Okay, yes, there were two different people. Thank you. Dow before Wyckoff. The methodology, again, this is kind of similar. You're talking about different types of trends, fluctuations, institutional traders. You know, it's pretty close, right? I think if Wyckoff did some writing, which I'm sure he did somewhere, he brought up Dow theory plenty, and people made that parallel plenty of times. ChatGPT also pointing out volume, which to me, again, kind of a softball. They're both, ChatGPT says volume is a secondary consideration of Dow, primary in Wyckoff. Okay, I guess. And then again, market participants, smart money. It's pretty close. It's pretty, pretty close. I just really like that Dow labels things. It takes it a step further, right? Beyond Dow theory. So I hope this was helpful. I hope it helps you maybe understand in the broader scheme of things when you start to see products coming online, headlines, maybe we have some IPOs in 2024, right? Come back to this video maybe a year from now and try to re-identify where we're at. Maybe even print out, you know, the various versions of market cycles and label like where you think we are, right? And this is going to be different for different charts, right? It's going to look different for ETH relative to BTC. It's going to look different for Solana relative to some of these other micro caps. So that's all for this one. Like, dislike, comment, share, subscribe, and happy trading.